Welcome to Shanti Peaceful Mathematics. In the previous video, we have learned about what is the limit of functions, which says that if you have a domain D, which is subset of R square, and this D is an open set if I consider, and this point AB, which is in D. Why we are taking open set? Because there exists some neighborhood of AB should exist in D. So that's why this open set is needed. Says that if limit of this function is exist, for that we can have a definition for every given epsilon greater than 0. There exists a delta greater than 0 such that 0 less than mod of x minus a less than delta, 0 less than y minus b less than delta implies that mod of f of xy minus l is less than epsilon, where your l is also belongs to R, which you are considering. Then we can say that the limit of f of xy will be l as xy tends to ab. In one variable case, you have, let's say, function f is defined on e to r, where e is a subset of r, then you are defining as the limit of this function f of xy is l as x tends to x0. When you are saying that this function f is continuous at x0, if this limit is equal to f of x0, if f of x0, then we can say that f is continuous at the point x0. And in the graphically, you can say that if this is the point x0 and if this is the graph of the function, when you are traveling to left hand side and right hand side, then it has to be approaching this point f of x0 here. So it is moving around the curve according to your y is also moving along the curve. So that's by that meaning, we can also copy that same idea here and we'll try to state that the continuous functions for functions of two variable, that we can say that limit f of xy will be f of ab as xy tends to ab, then we can say that f is continuous at the point ab. So it has to be satisfying three conditions. The first one is f is exist at ab, that means f of ab is exist. Second thing is this limit of f of xy as xy tends to ab is exist. And third condition is it is exist and it is equal to f of ab. So that is the verifying condition for functions of two variable as a continuity at the point AB. Three conditions should satisfy. At point AB, the value of the function is exist. A limit at the point AB, the limit is exist. And the third condition is limit is same as the value of the function at that point. So with that, we can state or we can define continuous function in the epsilon delta definition as for given epsilon greater than 0, there exists a delta greater than 0 such that mod of x minus a less than delta, mod of y minus b less than delta implies that f of xy minus f of ab is less than epsilon. Here I am taking a neighborhood, not I am taking related neighborhood, because we are approaching this xy point has to be approaching to the point ab. So that AB point is needed here in the definition of a continuous function. If this is there, then we can say definitely say that f is continuous at the point AB. Now, with the help of that and with the help of some results in the limit, we'll state this results. If you have f and g, both the functions are defined over D to R, where D is a subset of R square, which contains the point AB, and it is an open set. All obviously we are taking. And if you can say f and g are continuous at ab, then f plus g, f minus g, f into g, and r into f, where r is, I am taking as a real number, r continuous at AB, which state that the sum of two continuous function is continuous, subtraction of a two continuous function is continuous, product of two continuous function is continuous, if you multiply a constant with a continuous function, that's also a continuous function, and if f upon g is defined, then f upon g is also continuous at point AB. We are not going to discuss this proof of this theorem. Next result is also very interesting. It's about the composition of a two continuous function. So if I consider a function f which is defined over d, as I already stated, what is the meaning of a d? I'm taking as a domain. If it is a continuous, if f is continuous at point AB, obviously this AB point, it is in the d, and I'm defining a g which is a define over e to r, where e is a subset of r, g is a continuous at point f of AB. So here f I'm considering as a continuous at the point AB, and g is a continuous at f of AB, then we can say that g o f is continuous at AB. So here what is the situation you have? You have your function f which is from d to r, and from r, or you can say e is a subset of r, so you can have d to e, and e to r is another function. So, and this is the function f, this will be the g, so g o f is defined and it is continuous at AB. So it is also says that the composition of a two continuous function is continuous. Now with the help of these two results and this definition, we'll try to solve lots of examples. Let's state the first example, prove that the function f from r square to r define as f of xy equal to sine x into y is continuous everywhere. That means for any point this function sine of xy is continuous. So for that I am defining a function g which is from r to r as g of theta is equal to sine theta. You just recall that in your one variable case, suppose sine t square is there, then sine t square is also composition of a two function, sine theta and t square, and you apply first t square and then sine theta, it will give me sine square t. In the same manner, we have this function sine of xy, which is also composition of another. So I am defining another function which is from h square to r, which is h of xy will be defined as x into y. Now if you define g o h at xy, it is g of h of xy will gives you g of xy, and here it is sine theta. If theta, if you consider as xy, so this will be sine of x into y. So that means this is nothing but the, this function will be f of xy. So we can say that this sine function, we already know it is a continuous everywhere, and this is a product of two continuous function. So that's why it is also continuous function. H is also continuous everywhere on domain R square. So that's why your f, and it is a composition of a two continuous function. So that's why f is also a continuous function. Let's have the example discuss that the continuity of the following function at 0, 0. Say I'm writing as a function, so I'm solving many examples with the same title or with the same thing. So every time I'm not stating the same way. You just take it as f of xy as a function I'm defining as xy upon square root of x square plus y square, where xy is not equal to 0, 0, and 0 if it is 0, 0. So the question is to calculate what will be the continuity of this function at the point 0, 0. First, you should note that this function is continuous except 0, 0. Why? Because you can see that this function xy is continuous. The square root of x square plus y square is also continuous, and it is a division of two continuous function in its domain. So that's why this function is continuous except 0, 0. This function is have a problem only at 0, because at 0 it deflects its value. At 0 the values are changing. Otherwise this function is continuous everywhere except 0. So with that keep in mind, at 0 we need to check the continuity. So it has to be satisfying three conditions. The first one is f of ab should exist. Here what is f of ab is f of ab is 0, 0, which is already exist. So that's no problem with that. The second condition was, it says that limit of f of xy at xy tends to ab. Here ab is 0, 0, so I am just writing 0, 0 here, is exist. So this limit has to be exist. If it is exist, we need to prove that that is equal to 0. That is the third condition. So first let us try to check whether the limit is exist or not. So for that what you need to prove is, if it is exist, see in the limit exist, you want to prove that it is limit is exist. Just see the power. In the numerator it will have a 2 power, because this is x power 1, y power 1, so it is a power 2. In the denominator is a sum of two functions, so both have the power 2, so the common quantity has the power 2, and its square root is there, so the power will be in the denominator will be 1. So here the numerator has the more power, so there are chances are there this limit of this function at 0, 0 it exists. So with that thinking, we just trying to show that, we will show that for given epsilon greater than 0, there exists a delta greater than 0 such that 0 less than mod of x minus 0 less than delta and 0 less than y minus 0 less than delta implies that f of xy minus 0 is less than epsilon, because your L is 0 here. So that's we are proving. So you just note on this side, we are starting with this side. If you recall the examples we did in the for the limit, we are doing the same thing. So we're starting with f of xy minus 0. F of xy, you just see that it is xy upon square root of x square plus y square minus 0. We need to show that this will be less than epsilon. So there is no problem with the numerator, because numerator is nothing but the mod of x into mod of y, and mod of x mod of y, due to this it will be less than delta. So now the question is of the denominator. So you need to settle out the denominator will be less than something. So for that you just observe that x square is greater than or equal to 0 that we have already have, and that will implies x square plus y square is greater than or equal to y square if I add y square in this inequality. And if I take the square root both side, positive square root, this will gives me square root of x square plus y square greater than or equal to mod of y. So this will gives me mod of y upon square root of x square plus y square is less than 1. Aha! So that's we have here. So using that, we can state that this is mod of x mod of y upon square root of x square plus y square will be less than or equal to mod of x, due to this, because this quantity which we have, which is less than 1, so that's why this is less than or equal to x, and this will less than delta, as we already have in the definition that mod of x is less than delta. And if you take your this epsilon is equal to delta, so what you can have is, for given epsilon greater than 0, there exists a delta, and delta is epsilon such that mod of x minus 0 less than delta mod of y minus 0 less than delta implies that mod of f of xy minus f of 0, 0, that is 0 less than epsilon. Now here I am not adding the deleted neighborhood because we know that the limit is 0. So I am just removing that, I am adding that 0.00 into this, and it have not makes any change in the definition. So that's why we can say that f is continuous at 0.00. So that's why we can say that this function is continuous everywhere. Let's solve this problem with another way. So I'm just doing the solution too. So as we know that we need to prove this statement, for given epsilon greater than 0 there exists a delta. So this condition you don't know. Given epsilon greater than 0 there exists a delta greater than 0 such that you have this. Here I'm also starting with mod of xy minus f of 0, 0, and that is 0 you have. So that is xy upon square root of x square plus y square. So what we did in the previous example, we have estimated this 1 upon square root of x square plus y square. So I am changing this coordinates into the polar one. So what will happen is this will be r square cos theta into sin theta, because it is x into y. So x is r cos theta, y is r sin theta, putting it r square cos theta plus sin theta, and then in the denominator you will have square root of r square, because it is r square common out, cos square plus sin square is 1, so that's why it is r square. So if you can see that this will be nothing but the mod of r cos theta into sin theta due to square root, 1r is left, and that r is cancelled with this r, 1r, so it will be this, and this will be less than or equal to mod r, because of mod of cos theta is less than or equal to 1, mod of sin theta is also less than or equal to 1, because you know that these functions are bounded by 1. Now the question is, what will be whether this mod of r is less than delta. So what you have is x is less than delta, mod of x is less than delta, mod of y is also less than delta, that is our condition requirement is there. If I make a square both side, you will have this, and if you add this two, you will have x square plus y square will be less than 2 delta square, and x square plus y square you know that it is r square less than 2 delta square, so r will be less than square root of 2 delta. So this will be nothing but the less than square root of 2 delta. If you consider this is as epsilon, so delta you can choose as epsilon by square root. So the question is to find out what is the delta. Okay, so what we can say in this case, for given epsilon greater than 0, there exists a delta which is epsilon by square root of 2 positive, such that mod of x minus 0 less than delta, mod of y minus 0 less than delta implies mod of f of xy minus f of 0, 0 less than epsilon. So we can say that f is continuous at 0, 0. Here in this examples I have done with the two ways. The first one is with the Cartesian coordinates and convert, and second one is converting into the polar coordinates. It's up to you which method you like, and you can go for that. So the next example, consider the function f of xy as x power 4 y power 4 upon x square plus y square power cube as xy not equal to 0, 0 and 0 if xy is 0, 0. So you consider this is as a function. Now this function is also splitted at 0. So only the continuity problem is having at 0, because otherwise this function is already continuous, because you can see that this is x power 4, y power 4 is also continuous function, and x square plus y power 4 power cube, it is also polynomial type, so it's why, that's why it is also continuous, and the division of a two continuous function is already continuous. The problem is at 0, 0. So if you want to check the continuity, you have to say the three conditions to satisfy. The first one is, at point the value is exists. So at 0, 0 we have already given 0 value, whether the limit of this function at 0, 0 is exist or not, that we need to check. So that we can check by comparing the power. Most probably that idea will work. So here in the numerator you will have the power 8 because it is y x power 4, y power 4, 4 plus 4 is 8. Here the functions are in addition in the denominator. And this is has a power 2, this will have the power 4. So the maximum power is 4. So you can take out that power and power cube is there. So it will be power 12. So denominator has the power 12. So here denominator have the more power than the numerator. So that means there are chances are there this limit is not exist. So now if you want to say this limit is not exist, now you have a two things. Either you can go with the iterated limits or repeated limits, you can prove that, or you can choose some path on which the answer is depends on that. So for that, let us consider x is equal to my square. I'm choosing y because it is x square is there, so I want to common out y raised to 4. I should have something y square term is here, so that's why y raised to 4 is common out from this, and so that's why we can have the arrangement like this. So if I put this one, so what will be the things is x y will be x m y square y, you will have is m y square power 4 into y power 4 upon m square y power 4 because it is x square, so instead of x square it is, if I put square, so it is x square, so it is m square y power 4 plus y power 4 whole cube. Now if I simplify this, this will be m raised to 4 and this is 2 into 4, that will be 8, and 8 plus 4, that will be 12, so it is y power 12 you will have. In the denominator you will have m square plus 1 power cube into y power 12 because y raised to 4 is common out, power cube is y raised to 12, so that y raised to 12 is cancel out, and if you take limit of f of xy as xy tends to 0, 0, and you can just see that if y tends to 0, your x is also tends to 0. So that's why I can write as limit of y tends to 0, m power 4 upon m square plus 1 whole cube. So that is m power 4 upon m square plus 1 whole cube. That is the answer, which depends on m. Since this is depends on m, we can say that the limit does not exist, because if you change the value of m, the limit will change. So that's why it is path dependent limit. So we can say that this function is not continuous at point 0, 0. Let's have the another example. This is the third one with the same thing. Discuss the continuity at 0, 0. And the function I am taking as f of xy as sine of x square plus y square upon 1 minus cos square root of x square plus y square. And xy is not equal to 0, 0, and 0 if xy is 0, 0. Here is also same thing is there, at 0 the values are splitted. This function is continuous everywhere except 0 because we don't know yet what is happening at 0, but otherwise it will be continuous function. Now here I am using another trick to show that whether it is continuous or discontinuous at 0. First of all, the three conditions to satisfy that I'm talking in the first two example, same way, what will be the f of 0, 0 is there, which is 0. We already have the value given to us, so that's why there is no problem with that. The second one, whether the limit is exist or not. So here they are the two trigonometric functions, it is not like polynomial function. So here we cannot count the powers and all sort of thing. We cannot do that here. One advantage is in this trigonometric functions you have, this is x square plus y square term, and the same term will have here. So you now consider this as x square plus y square is equal to t square. So if you consider x square plus y square is equal to t square, this limit f of xy tends to 0, 0, this will have the limit sine t square, because in the numerator you will have the sine of t square upon 1 minus t square. So that is gives me 1 minus cos t, and as your x is tending to 0 and y is tending to 0 due to this, you will have this will tends to t is also tends to 0, because x is tending to 0, y is tending to 0, so x square plus y square is also tending to 0, so that is t is tends to 0 you have. So this is now the limit in terms of one variable. Now how to compute this limit? That probably this limit you have done in your 12th standard. So that is sine t square upon 1 minus cos t is there. This is 0 by 0 form you have. You can see that sine 0 is 0, cos 0. So you can apply the L'Hospital rule. That will gives me limit t tends to 0. That is gives me cos t square into 2t upon minus sine t. Cos derivative of cos t is minus sine t. So that will be minus minus plus. And so this will gives me, you can see that we can write this is t tends to 0. This is also 0 by 0 form, but we can simplify this is very simple way, that is cos t square into 2 upon sine t upon t. And you know that limit t tends to 0, sine t, t upon t is 1. So that's why it is limit of cos t square into 2. As t tends to 0, and as t tends to 0, cos is a continuous function, so it is 2 into cos 0. 2 into cos 0 will be gives me 2, and which is not equal to f of 0, 0. F of 0, 0 is 0 is given, so that's why this function is not continuous function. So we can say that f is not continuous at 0, 0. See here, the limit is exists, but it is not equal to the value of the function at 0. Let's have the fourth example. F of xy equal to xy into x square minus y square upon x square plus y square. Xy is not equal to 0, 0, and 0 if xy is 0, 0. So here again f of 0, 0 is there, which is 0. You check whether the limit exists. This is polynomial upon polynomial form. So you just count the power in the numerator. You will have the power here 1. Here you will have 1. So it is 1 plus 1, 2 power. And this will be in the addition term. This term is addition. So that's why it is of power 2. So in the numerator you will have a power 2 plus 2, 4. So it is 4 power. And the denominator you will have a 2 power. So numerator has the more power. So there are chances are there this function is continuous, or this limit is of this function is exist. So and it is given as a zero limit, so you just try to check whether this f of xy minus 0 is something bounded by or not, or some quantity is or not. So what we need to prove is for every given epsilon greater than 0, there exists a delta greater than 0 such that mod of x minus y less than delta 0 less than mod of y minus 0 less than delta implies f of xy minus L less than epsilon. L is here 0 we have taken. So that's why I'm considering this. This is equal to xy into x square minus y square upon x square plus y square. As I told you earlier, or we have solved the first example by taking converting this is into the polar coordinates. It's up to you how you are estimating this function. So I'm just taking x is equal to r cos theta and y is equal to r sin theta here, and if I substitute that value, this will becomes r square cos theta sin theta, because it is xy, and here if I put, then r square will be common out. You'll have cos theta minus cos square theta minus sine square theta, and in the denominator you will have x square plus y square, so it is r square. This r square will cancel with this, and cos square theta minus sine square theta is cos 2 theta, so that will be simplified as mod of r square sin theta cos theta into cos 2 theta will be mod of r square by 2. I'm multiplying and dividing by 2 here, because you know that the sin 2 sin theta into cos theta is sin 2 theta, so that will gives me r square upon 2 sin 2 theta into cos 2 theta. So that will be, I'm multiplying and divided by 2 here, so that will be r square upon 4 2 into sin theta sin 2 theta into cos 2 theta, and 2 into sin theta into cos 2 theta will be sin 4 theta. So that's why this is nothing but the mod of r square upon 4 sin 4 theta, and sin 4 theta is less than 1, so that will be less than r square upon 4. Now I want that this will be less than epsilon, so for that you will have mod of x is less than delta, mod of y is less than delta, so that is x square plus y square is less than 2 delta square. So r square is less than 2 delta square, so less than 2 delta square upon 4, so that will be less than delta square by 2. Then you can choose that this is less than epsilon. What will be your delta is? Delta will be square root of 2 epsilon. So we can say for every given epsilon greater than 0, there exists a delta. Delta is square root of 2 epsilon, such that mod of x minus 0 less than delta, mod of y minus 0 less than delta implies that f of xy minus 0 less than epsilon. So with that we can say that f is continuous at the point 0, 0. Let's have the next example. Let's have the example f of xy is equal to x square plus y square upon x square plus y square plus x minus y power 4, as xy is not equal to 0, 0, and 0 if xy is 0, 0. Here is also have the same thing. At 0, 0, we have a problem. Otherwise, the function is already look continuous. So, you just count the power. At 0, 0, the function have the value 0, that is f of 0, 0 is already exist and it is possible. Now to check or find out the limit, you need to verify whether the limit is exist or not. For that, you just find out whether at 0, 0, what will be the situation. For that, you can count the power. So here in the numerator, you will have a 4 power. In the denominator, here you have a 4 power. Here is also 4. So numerator and the denominator have the same power. So there are chances are there this function may or may not be continuous. So I'm giving you this exercise as homework. So I'm giving you a hint that you take this path y is equal to mx, and in that path this function is depends on the path y is equal to mx, so that's why the limit is does not exist, so that's why this function is not continuous at this point. Also you can check with the help of the repeated limits this thing. So you can take this is one of the way, or another way is by taking a repeated limit. You can check whether the repeated limits are equal or not. This is the hint to solve this example. With that, I'm giving you another few example to checking the continuity of the some function. Discuss the continuity of the following function. The first one, f of xy is equal to x square plus y square. So I'm not saying that at point 0, 0. So you have to check whether it is continuous everywhere. Okay. So the whatever the domain of the function is. The second one is f of xy, I'm defining as x square minus y square upon x square plus y square, as xy is 0, 0, and 4 if xy is 0, 0, so here it is non-zero. The third one is, I'm saying it is x square sin y by x, as x is non-zero, and 0 if x is 0. So with this three example, as an exercise, I'm stopping this and just recalling what we did in this video, we have defined a continuous function. Continuous function says that satisfying the three conditions, the first one is at 0, 0 or at AB, the function has the value. At that point, AB point, the limit of the function is exist. And the third one, a limit exists. Whatever the limit is there, the answer has to be matched with the value of the function at that point, that is at AB. That is the definition of a continuous function we have defined. We have seen that the sum of two continuous function is continuous, product of two continuous function is continuous, division also continuous, subtraction is also, we have seen it is a continuous, and we have did the composition of a two continuous function is continuous. So with the help of that, we solve so many examples here in this video. And that's it for this video. If you have liked this video, please press the like button. If you have any comments, suggestion or any questions, please drop down in a comment box. Thank you very much. Bye bye. Sayonara.